Okay, here's my first counter breadboard. Here we go.
Hey, it's Fran. Again. Here's some magazine print with one of Missy's cat hairs on it. And zooming in, you can see the individual pixels and the print. So there you go. For a few dollars and a spent toilet paper roll, you too can have your own microscope. How cool is that? This is my IBM Selector 2, and I'm going to show you how to take care of it. And the little tiny indicator here, that's the, tells you where the, that should do it. It's all ready to go. I'm ready to type. Hey, it's Fran again, and again in my lab. Got my Commodore t-shirt on. Turn on the power and ta-da. Okay. There you go. That's my boot up program. Run. Sketchpad. See, it's drawing the... I wasn't really sure because the controls, but I'd forgotten all about this program, but I actually made it pretty intuitive. It actually has a help key. So if I push the H, it will actually bring up this little help menu. It's actually fairly sophisticated for something written in BASIC. Till next time, I'm Fran. See you back at the lab. Bye.
Shut up, fool. I pity the fool. Shut up, fool. I pity the fool. Shut up, fool. I pity the fool. Shut up, fool. Don't give me no. Don't give me no. Don't give me no. Shut up, fool. I pity the fool.
Wow. It is alive. Exactly how hot is it? I don't really know, but it's pretty friggin' hot. Hey, it's Fran. Again, it is working. It's done. Look at that. Fireflies. This is a spin welder from Mattel. And in the early 70s, this was probably the most dangerous toy that could be bought for a child, and also probably one of the most awesome toys ever. Put a weld in. All right. To be honest, that's actually, that weld is pretty awful. That's a really bad weld. That is really good. That's better than I thought. I mean, that's like, that is so much stronger than glue. I mean, you can't do this with a glued T-joint like this with plastic leverage. It's like, wow, look at that. That's like really... really, oh, that is not coming apart. Look at that. That is like as strong as if it were molded in one piece. Ta-da! Spin welding.
Coffee break, where I can have a sandwich and remember.
In my opinion, this is the most important circuit board in history. It is a computer board. Comes from something called the Launch Vehicle Digital Computer, which was the computer that operated the Saturn V moon rocket. I don't mind x-raying my hand for science.
Okay. You want to hold it like...
Yeah, you guys get a lot more exposure than I do.
There's your finger.
Yeah, hold on. It's my,
Your bone.
That's my bone.
All right. It's not broken.
So that's awesome. I've exposed myself to every solvent and carcinogen known. Oh, that looks very promising. Yeah, that's very nice. Made this out of scrap wood in a friend's basement because back in 1988 I didn't actually have any power tools. I actually just took the guts out of a desktop fluorescent lamp. The bulb sits in the focal point of that parabolic reflector so that when you put the diffuser down, there's no hot spot. First thing I do is clean off the copper board with some denatured alcohol. It's also a very good idea to wear gloves during this whole process. Heat press is preheated to 165 degrees Celsius, and the water in the cotton instantly turns to steam. You have to grab the edge there to pull out the board, and it goes into the water pan. And then with the long end, just a slight little pull, and you peel off the blue backing, and it's done. Works good every time. Ferric chloride is very, very dark. It's completely etched. Etched and ready to move on, we're going to take the resist off. That's pretty much it. There you go. Nice clean board. And that is ready to drill. To put the components through and solder. I've actually been making circuit boards for a really long time. This is the first professional circuit board that I ever designed. Back in 1994, it was for the original Hepcats. Each of those holes is centered on the drill register where a hole's gonna be drilled in the PC board. Top piece would go on top of the stack. This is the biggest one for the Glacier. Every individual board, each board has its own die. There's the Vibutron. Pop it in. It's a nice tight fit, and it'll just snap right into the back of the camera. You want to make sure that that all of the paper tabs are also out and not folded under. Before you actually snap the back shut, wiggle the light seal out a little bit. You just want to get it started, because I find that if you don't start it before you snap the back shut, it might tear in half because it's very hard to pull out. I set the exposure about midway because it's a semi-overcast day, and you grab the large tab and pull it out nice and slow. Now what it's just done is it's broken a reservoir of developer. I'm going to tear the wax paper and grab the backing, and at 60 seconds I will remove the backing with the developer. And then grabbing the corner of the actual photograph, I'm going to pull off the edge mask. And this will continue to develop for the next minute or so and get darker and higher in contrast. And there you go. There's my azaleas in living Polaroid color. I'm Fran. Thanks for watching. Thank you. Fran, again, and in my new lab. Cool Tektronix 564 storage scopes here. I've got lots and lots of toys. I've got this stuff here. Got that stuff there. All right, I'll see you soon. FranLab.
Suitcase in my hand. Jack is in his corset and Jane, she's in her vest. And me, I am a rock and roll band. Yes, I am.
Yes, you are.
A riding the Stutz Bearcat Blue. Oh, those were different times. When poets studied the rules of verse and the ladies, they'd roll their
fighting style. It's Fran fighting style. And this is my rant about conspiracy nuts.
Sometimes it works, sometimes it doesn't. The Jill and Julia Show.
Thanks for Julia Sweeney. Julia Sweeney!
Fran! I'm so happy to be here with Fran.
I can't believe that I'm...
Oh, please.
Really? So, thank you, Julia.
And Fran.
Thank you. Oh, so.
Fran's the best.
I'm so happy. Me want to cry.
Oh.
I was the owner of, like, the only existing biplane machine, which is actually, you'll find, if you go to the KLOV, the killer list of video games, if you go to the biplane, you'll see that the one in there, that was mine. And I actually ended up donating that to a museum. Because it's just so rare. Then I've got a Zaxxon, which I would show you, except the monitor's gone. This is actually an original Japanese Donkey Kong. And actually I had to modify it. I had to put an extra board on there. This is a dedicated, this is Galaga. This was the dedicated Galaga board. Another dual delete. I'll get a close-up of some of the chips. I'll show you how small these transistors are. This is one that I just opened up, and actually you can see that where the tip of, that's the tip of a pencil for scale. So these are extremely small. I just got like one strand of that tiny, tiny plastic brush. There it is. A little bit of potting still inside, but you can definitely see the traces there. There we go. It is out. Success! High. 0.64 volts. See? Take the last input and I'll switch it high. And output is 5 volts. It's an and.
Down in Louisiana, where the alligators grow so deep. Hey, little girl, I swear to the world. The alligators look tame. Sally Danny. Gator get your granny. Everybody said it was a shame. Cause her mama was a wagon on the chain.
It's my love affair with the light-emitting diode. Broken out of the box, used for the first time. Late 60s era, early 70s maybe, Monsanto. And that's really the close-up of that larger segmented display. Got it bugged the other way, but one of the segments isn't working, or at least it's not making connection. Might be tarnished pins, but there you go. These are the first blue LEDs, and these are just so expensive when they came out. And they're based on silicon carbide. It's sort of an odd blue. It's not, like I said, these are really dim. It's sort of a watery, pale blue. When you're feeling down and life seems pointless, happiness is a 10-pound bag of 7-segment LEDs. Be so happy. Me want to cry. It's actually filled with gas. It's filled with neon gas, typically, which is why they're orangish in color when they turn on. And unlike the vacuum fluorescent display, the Nixie tube does not actually have any filaments. There's no filaments. There's nothing to heat up. The Nixies run cold. There's a behind the filaments, in front of the display, there's a very, very fine mesh screen, and that's the grid. And the grid is charged to a very high positive potential. These tubes take a 24-volt grid by a really interesting copper oxide rectifier, solid-state rectifier. You can see it on the side here. Of magnetic flux to current is reversed. So in the secondary, you actually have a voltage there. It's actually going to be ahead of the current by 90 degrees. So this is the primary, and this is the secondary. And I put them together. Okay. As I change the frequency, lowering the frequency,
but that was early. That was September 8th. It's K4.
Spectrum, which was a color one.
Well, but it's prestigious. It's UC Berkeley.
Happy UC Berkeley.
Yep. So this is me on acid.
Exactly, yeah. This is your brain on acid.
Through a pet.
Exactly.
Now I'm in Commodore heaven. Look at all those Commodores. C64s, wall to wall. But I really thought this would be the appropriate point to show the shirt that I've been wearing all day. If anyone gets it, get it? It's Fran, again, but I'm not in my lab, I'm in Bill's lab. This is Bill Hurd, the famous Commodore guy. It's Bill Hurd, and we're going to do this new show on YouTube. It's called The Dino Den. It's going to call it The Dinosaur Den, and it's going to be a sketch comedy and music and singing and guitar and music.
It's going to be about science and electronics and how to figure stuff out and very few explosions.
Give me a little bit of singing. Okay, hey. I'm in the music department for the Dinosaur Den. Oh, here is Guitar World, April 2003. Review of the Glacier called The Big Chill. Up there. Glacier Hypermodulator. One of my most sophisticated effects, and probably the hardest to understand. Setting it clockwise, you'll speed up the watch. You can see the fine turning finish on all of the bridges. Just beautiful to look at. They really went all out in these to make them slotted nut, and there's this curved threaded rod. Gotta love handhelds, right? Hey, it's Fran again. Hey, I just wanted to thank everybody who subscribed to my little channel. 10,000 subscribers plus. Wow. Why? That's what I say. Why so many subscribers to this little channel? But anyway, thank you for everyone who has subscribed.
Hi, she's Fran Blanche.
And he's Bill Hurd.
And together we're the Everly Brothers. No, we're the Dinosaur Den.
Dinosaur Den, baby. Yeah. Number 3.
What is a dinosaur, though? Why are we dinosaurs?
Because we're old and grizzled and antiquated and old-fashioned and...
Unfortunately, while we were recording, we had an error, and it was a whopper.
I'm Fran Blanche.
Oh, I was waiting for you to go. Here I am again. All right.
Oh, and that's my own little
That's
thing.
Your other thing. Yeah, I know.
That's the other...
Well, I did my patented here in the headlights look.
That's the other channel.
All right.
It's made for
it's
people.
It's for people. It's for people.
They blew it up. Damn you.
Damn you all. You don't have to be a star, baby, to be on my show. No, no.
She's trying to embarrass me.
He says, these are your diskies. And I was like, my diskies? He says, yeah. He says, there's five of them. And there were five boxes, and each one had a genuine Apollo disky in it. I took that photograph of the working disky from the NASA archives, and taking this photo, which I took of the display that I took out of the disky at Garber, I corrected the photo, the NASA photo, for perspective based on the actual item that I had, and superimposed the two images together in alignment to within, you know, less than a millimeter. So I got so far as to making the composite drawing, which combined the NASA stock photograph of the working disky with the panel display that I pulled. And that culminated in many, many hours of rendering to this line drawing, what the original would be in relation to the silkscreened elements, and come up with this. This is the definitive representation of all the elements. Pieces of the disky laid out on the table. I made all my measurements. We took lots of photographs. I had transparent scaling rulers so we could actually scale the whole thing. Even though I could only really measure the specific contours of the disky display itself, I didn't have that much time. I did take scaled photographs of the remainder of the disky so that it would be possible to faithfully reproduce the entire disky, because I thought it would be really cool to be able to just quickly attach different outputs. But this just shows the 4017 in action as a decade counter. So when I had the other board attached, you could see that the LEDs were turning on 1 through 10, or 0 through 9, however you want to. I decided for my project that I was going to use a super, super awesome vintage Monsanto Man 72. And again, that's the reason for this complicated three-dimensional matrix, because I've got segments going horizontally and I've got digits going vertically, you see. And again, I made mine count from 1 to 0, which some people will probably take offense to, that you should start with 0 and end with 9, but hey, I'm making the rules, it's mine, so I start with 1.
Here.
Brian!
Hey!
We're in Asbury Park.
Yep.
On the boardwalk. And here's proof.
There's skee ball.
There's the ocean.
There's pinball.
And there's pinball, baby. Back at the VCF East.
Yes.
Brian, back from the boardwalk. No pinball for us. Maybe next year.
I've never seen any. I've eaten any.
How many modules are in this thing?
Around 220.
I was here.
This is a 50-year-old computer. That's pretty sweet.
This is what it's like.
Yeah, we're just hanging out. With used pizza.
Here's some money. Used pizza.
Blooper reels.
Not half an hour.
Anyway.
We actually went down to the
museum
in Indianapolis.
Email Ryan.
Hey, you know, saw the blooper reels and heard Gene talk.
Bye. It's cassette time with Fran. It's cassette time with Fran. Cassette time with Fran.
Kickstarter campaign for the Peach Fuzz is sold out. Hey, it's Fran again, and I'm in the historic John Wanamaker building in Philadelphia, and I'm here to do something really special, because that behind me, behind that artificial facade, is the world's largest functioning musical instrument.
Wow, look at these pipes. These are huge. Wow. This is astonishing. Look at this. Thing I've ever heard in my life. It is off. But yeah, I'm Fran Blanche, and I guess are people here, are you here because of interest in entrepreneurship or tech or any musicians? All the above. So have you heard of my company, Frantown, or what I do, or? Because we could just go to my YouTube channel and just skip this whole thing. Oh, hey, Peach Fuzz, excellent. Okay, well, I got one of my children in the house. All right, so this is where it begins. A long time ago, retail hell. Yeah, I was stuck in retail for the majority of my 20s. I had a string of dead-end retail management jobs. I did just about everything. I sold video cassettes and shoes. This is me. This is 1989, because I'm 22. I was tinkering together the pedals there. And I got a write-up in Guitar Player magazine, and this is 1996, like a year after we had released it. I got a write-up in the York paper. So here I am with Carl Barbro. We've just disassembled a Block One disky there. It's all discombobulated. And we did put it back together. It looks worse than it really was. But that was also on my blog. I blogged about that. So, and this is another reverse. Technological archaeology project. The Maillard Day automaton at the Franklin Institute, which you can go and see anytime, there's been an ongoing restoration effort to try and bring the machine back to its original state. It's been going on for over 10 years, but I got into it a couple years ago. I had to improvise quite a bit to test my theories about floating stylus writing instrument that was originally used with the automaton. And I came up with a way of doing the experiment with a modern pen using a Pilot G2 that I am carving down here to fit the hand of the automaton, that the barrel of the pen is being pushed towards the paper during downstrokes. And again, this is showing that pumping action, where if we were using a floating stylus with an ink reservoir, the valve would be opening as the pen is pushed towards the paper, and the valve would be closing as the pen is lifted from the paper, and that would be creating variations in the ink flow as the stylus is moving around the paper. And this was really what I wanted to record, this this translation of the Z-axis cams, revealing what would be hidden subtleties in the writing. That last cam was it was clearly added later. It's not original to the machine, which increases the debate about the origins of the machine. I think that my personal opinion is that the automaton was actually created by the Jacques Draw shop, and that the Maillardet shop was contracted in making the cams. And sometime after the machine was finished, the Maillardet shop went back and replaced that last cam with one that personalized it to, and also to come up with a procedure to set the counterbalance spring so that the ink flow would be equal when the hand is fully extended and when it's also withdrawn. Fran, again, and this is my IBM Selectric 2, which was the topic of my very first video on this channel. Here it is, reassembled. All right. Okay. Just snaps in like that, pretty simple. All right, back together. Cool, really quiet. And thanks too for all of the people who are pledging to my Patreon page. We have a few in the credits who have pledged to made to be my top supporters. And yeah, thanks. It's really starting to make a dent. You are truly keeping the lights on at this point. Actually, in reality. So thanks to everyone who has pledged support to my channel, and I hope that I can continue to make worthy content to earn your subscription. And Missy hopes so too. So alright, so that's it. I'll see you soon. I'm Fran, and this is Missy. Bye. Records, how to clean them, and some ways that you can play them. It's pretty straightforward. You just kind of... The Lenny and the Sweet Tones record has a cool inner sleeve because it's the very first time that a very young Nigel Tufnell was playing lead guitar. See him right there? Yeah. Nigel Tufnell, lead guitar.
Busy and demanding as it was, basic training did have its pauses. The welcome smoke breaks and mail from home.
Smooth out the glue and sort of just evenly distribute it. There is a technique to it. Maybe something I'll try again, but probably not. It's really messy. It takes a long time, and trying to get all the glue off, it's a real pain in the butt. It really is, so...
And you have to buy the license every month or every year that you want to use it, and then for the parts, for the footprints, and especially a lot of specialized parts that I use that, you know, don't have a standard footprint. Go through, after I've done the design 3 or 4 times, going through the whole, you know, design, piece by piece, looking at every single, you know, layer, and
grabbing a tool here. First drill bit. And then it just goes to town. It's just amazing to watch this go. Doing this process by hand, I do not miss. This is one of the examples where machinery is definitely superior to having a human being doing a drudgerous, is that even a word, drudgerous? But I will claim it here, task. It's just really amazing to watch it go. And then the whole sandwich goes into the machine to be exposed for several minutes under ultraviolet light to go to the etching baths. This is a negative process because for these double-sided boards, because they're plated through holes, the negative resist is actually used, and then this board will go to an electroplating bath, which will plate on the tin where the copper is going to remain. I know from my own personal experience that just being able to mix printing ink the right way and get it to the right consistency and get the thinner and the retarders and everything mixed just right it's like an art in itself. And having just the right touch to be able to screen the ink through in just the right amount, just the right pressure, it just really is a very fine art. And there we go, one printed board. To break the boards, the individual boards, out of the panel for doing the soldering and assembly work, a working board so that will have a finished clean panel of boards that we can actually use when we do the final assembly. The occasional piece of dirt that'll get on the board in the optical process and cause a little piece of copper to remain and cause a short, or you can have an open.
Bingo.
Congratulations, it passed. Oh, and here it is. The Frantome Brooklyn printed circuit board. So much time went into this. It really is like one of the greatest expenses of manufacturing.
Cool. Thanks everyone for coming. This is the second meme colloquium talk of this year.
A pedal that I really wanted to make that had the look, sound, the feel. I wanted it to be something really out there. Something that if it were made, I would just think it was the coolest thing ever. Mm-hmm. And I made this. This is the prototype for the Fuzzy Wagon. This was supposed to be the first Frantone pedal. It cost so much money and took so much time. It would be part two. But thank you. It's really neat just because the matrix of calcite gives it this really awesome refractive property. I'm going to use the super zoom on the new camera. Look at this. Look at that. Super zoom. Rotate the calcite. Look at the... Oh yeah, there we go. Alright. Awesome refractiveness. I just love optical calcite. It's just so much fun. Let's go take a look at the schematic that they provided with the model. So here's the schematic. It's my photocopy of the schematic that was at the Royal Society. Of these 2N404As, I think they're marked GI. Is that General Instruments? I'm not really sure. Trying to lay out the components exactly the same way as on the schematic, so it'll be kind of easier to see the final result is how it's oscillating. If you look at the scope trace, you can see it's actually not turning on and off. It's really just sweeping. Battery and close it up. All right, first time heard since 1957, perhaps 58, who knows when the battery went dead in that thing. But here it goes. Okay, so this is what it sounds like going overhead. It's a drawing. It's 28 by 32 inches. It's halftone holly. And yeah, 4 weeks. I spent months preparing to do the piece, researching halftone and figuring out ways of doing transitions and trying to come up with standards of drawing dots and squares and transitioning them and looking at halftone photographs with magnifying glasses, and it's just so much work. And I inked the whole thing with fountain pen, and after I'd gotten all the details done, I went in and filled in the big areas with brush, and the whole thing came together, and I was very pleased with the results. Halftone holly. A month of my life, but it's time well spent. I'm very happy with it. It's very satisfying. Did a final schematic rendering in ProTel. And if I adjust the trim pot, this is the range it goes through now. Sounds pretty good. So now I went to ProTel to do the board layout and do a final version for the copper. Went to paper and drew out some notes, figuring out about what the shape should be and doing some calculations just so I can go to AutoCAD and then build up the model. And I use AutoCAD 2000. It's what I know. And when I had the models made up, I could export them. And then I had to put them into a slicer, Simplify 3D, which is a really good program. It's not cheap, but every printer's different, so it's like, you know, you just sort of have to work out the problems based on your environment and the kind of printer you have and the kind of setup you have and whatnot. So, but having all of the problems solved, it was time to actually go to print quality issues that I've had before I built the chimney for the printer. But there we go. There was the top enclosure with a very slight chamfer. And I had the holes drilled, but I did the base in black just like the original model. Pieces are firmly held together, and there you go. There it is, the Sputnik beeper box. Very happy how this turned out. It's a good experiment in really how this whole DIY thing can work. Having some fun with something new. Yeah. This is a really cool little setup I got going today on the bench. This is an IEE one plane readout bench supply. And here I've got a little regulated 5-volt supply that is powering the counter board. I've got a 555 timer running a 4017 decade counter, and the output of that is going through this header to this board I made yesterday, which is just a driver board. It's got 10 transistors that are switching the 5-volt output from the 4017. It's very important to make a prototype board, because when you go into like full production, it is expensive, it's a big investment, and if you have any mistakes on the board at all, no matter how minor they might be, from the fit of the board in the enclosure to where the holes for the mounting screws are, or even like lead spacing for a component or something, or even something as stupid as making an error on the board, well, it's very important to make sure that everything is 100% before you go and send it to the fab house to get hundreds of them made. And there's that extended tab that I just grab, and nice, easy. And there you go. Toner's transferred. I'm trimming down the board to actual size before I go to put it in the etchant. This is my high volume, low pressure ventilation system, and I've got it hooked up to my vent hood. And this is in my other video that I made many years ago showing about my home etching process. Now I'm just going to use ferric chloride because I'm only making a few boards here, but if you're making a lot of boards, like dozens of boards, you can do sodium persulfate. But now the copper is tarnished and oxidized from the pressing process, so just scrub off the oxidation. The copper is much harder than the FR4 board, so if you very slowly enter the bit, it will self-center circuit board and start with the resistors and work my way up, building up the board from the shortest to the tallest components. Board's done. And kind of arrange the wires, get the top piece on. Well, that's it. The Sputnik beeper box is prototyped. It's working. Case works. No rattling. It's, there you go. Having fun with something really cool. It's not an LED display. It's not a Nixie display. It's not a vacuum-fluorescent display. It's a pneumatron. Lots and lots of wiring and cutting and trimming and soldering. So, yeah. But one of the things, if you want to do base 10 displays, the counter is going to count to 15. Driver, used for muxing. You know, if you want to do multiplexing, these are really the chips you use. So now it's time to plug in the Pneumatron module and do the final test. As they say, put the fire to the wire. Find out if you made any really big mistakes. Although I'm sure that I haven't. I've been testing it as I go along. Pretty confident. Turn on the... There we go. Ah, beauty. There we go. Not fun! Not fun at all. So, did you have as much fun as I did? I thought so. For the display, really beautiful. Yep. Gotta love those displays. Goes into the guide, and then you can scale text to be able to translate the letters in the template onto the paper by use of a pen. I'm going to put a little bit of ink in the pen reservoir, and I'm doing this with a little syringe. Just got to put a little drop in there. Okay. Now you notice that the letter is actually completely straight up and down. And this adjusts the line thickness of the line that you want to, of the circle that you want to draw. You need to have an inkwell or a dropper to use this. You take that, you just dip the end of the pen into the inkwell, just to pull up a little bit of ink on it, like that. See a little drop of ink in there. And then you can set it, draw yourself a circle. So. It was a really cool effect, and So I really was thinking this would be the thing, and I thought about what to call it, and I came up with the name Photon Candy. So yeah, I was all set to go. I thought, you know, this will really be something. I can market this and just be a USB cable, no software. You just plug it into a spare USB jack, and there you go. You'll just be calming down in your cubicle. Yeah, and before I could even really, you know, launch or even like come up with a production prototype, came up on eBay. You know, it's like some Chinese company came out with strings of opaque white glowing orbs that had this same chip in it that you would just plug in the string of lights into the outlet and kaboom, you know. That was it. Oh, that is trippy. I made a light pop just out of stuff I had lying around. Hey, it's Fran again in my shop. And today I want to do a video about one of my favorite things in the world. The 45 RPM record. Just like this one, Fool's Paradise by the Crickets on Brunswick, 1958 original. This is a first for me, and also a first for YouTube, because as of today of my recording this is the first and only video on YouTube about the Nemo display tube, which looks like this. It works. I've been working on this project for weeks. This is an IEEE NIMO, N-I-M-O, digital display tube. It's a cathode ray tube, a little CRT, but all it does is display numbers. This one just displays 0 through 9. This is the most basic diagram showing the basic theory of operation. The tube, it's got the high voltage anode, a 1750 volt anode on one end. It's got a series of 10 grids, 0.15 volt tolerance for the filaments, so they're running a little bit low, but still within the operational range in my version. But I did that to get that 1.1 volts AC, and also because I had the center tap, I could put the cathode bias there. So I have made this sort of as a cascade power supply. So the trim pod for the 12 volts with Gliptol, after I dialed in exactly like 12.01 volts and I just locked it off. And then these I left variable because I knew I'd have to tweak them. So I designed the holder in AutoCAD and printed it out. Broke it up into four different parts because in order to get the kind of resolution on all the surfaces that I needed for all the different features, it was really most practical to print it in four parts and then bolt it all together. I'm very fortunate to have a group of people who support the channel, support the lab, keeps the lights on, keeps the roof over the lab, and so that's why we're doing it. And so we're making the videos just for you. This was retired for a while because it just the display had shut off, and it was because the filaments a crack had developed on the board here, and I've actually brought it back after I went through and troubleshot it and found the break, and I had to put in some wire in there to bridge, basically just take out the bypass the printed circuit board and just bridge a wire right to the connection on the filaments to bring the thing back to life. The last time I worked on it, it takes a leg off of the 24 volt supply. But they take the line there, just right off the transformer for the clock sync, 450. So now, if I switch the switch to the new mode, it should give me seconds and minutes. Let's see. Woo! Hey! It works! If I didn't do that intro, then how would you know that it's me? Could be anybody making these videos, honestly. Anyway, this is my completed Nemo clock project. Now, I did feature the Nemo tube in a video that a couple of people saw, you know, a few weeks ago, but for the purpose of making that video, I ran the Nemo tube with a wild clock. It was just a 555 clock. Kind of made it run seconds-y-ish, but not really like a real clock. But I wanted to make the Nemo tube into a single-digit clock, basically a clock that discounts accurate seconds. And it is! I did this with an AC synchronous clock circuit. But on the board, I also have tenths of seconds animated in a little running light. I have 10 LEDs in there that act like a little scanner to scan away the tenths of seconds. And I also even have an LED on there that pulses the individual tenths of seconds that comes out of the divide by six counter. I got the plexiglass case that I had made by a local fabricator. They did a really good job. So the whole thing is very like 1970-ish, like you could imagine seeing this on a table in 1972. You're setting up the counter to trip at a number that you're selecting out of its counting sequence. That's it for this one. Thanks for watching, and thanks to all of my patrons who sponsor me on Patreon. You are the reason that I am able to make these videos.
Cheater trick on this one. I'm going to add two little drops of silver nitrate directly to the developer right before I pour it on the plate. What that's going to do is kind of add like extra silver kind of floating around on the plate and add to my image density. Hopefully.
That which cannot be told. But those who are chemistry aficionados,
you know what it is.
You know what it is.
Start it right here. So it looks like we got a negative, but it's really a positive.
A little appealing, but probably salvageable.
And the varnish is something that makes these images last forever. Basically, it hermetically seals the front of your plate so that the silver can't ever be oxidized or tarnished by the environment. So what we're going to do is measure out some of this gum sandarac. And what this is basically shrub resin. And it's going to be little crystals, and there'll be bugs and sticks and all kinds of neat stuff in there. So you can see the sticks and crap floating around in there already. Once all the little jewels of sandarac are finished dissolving, we'll filter this into a much cleaner jar and then add some lavender oil to finish up our varnish. Pretty much the most permanent photographic process that there is.
Mm-hmm. And it's with this type of varnish, it's archival, mm-hmm. so like, yep. you know, acid, stable.
Mm-hmm. And you can, you know, even if the varnish gets like scratched or marred or spill something on it, the varnish can be stripped off of the plate and reapplied without damaging the image.
Yeah. I'm framed. Archival for all centuries.
Yep.
It's interesting to think that the only thing that of me that will survive in 1,000 years is this glass plate.
If anybody's around to see it.
If anyone's around to see it, yeah.
Hey, it's Fran again, and I'm actually in a building at the University of Pennsylvania, because the faculty here, they sent me an email and said that they had an old laboratory that they had to clear out to make new space for a new laboratory, and it was full of stuff, and they wondered if I wouldn't come by, and if it was interesting, maybe take it and use it for Fran Lab. So I'm pretty excited.
This is just, that's all meters.
Yeah.
This is all transformers. Look at these, mm-hmm. man, look at these resistors. These huge ohmite resistors. Wow. This is like, so,
fire box of one plane weight out.
Jesus.
Is that a display?
Yeah.
For numbers?
Yeah. It's a numerical display. Right. There was a Nemo tube in here, I'd crap myself. You know what did I just say? If there was a Nemo tube in here, I would crap myself. Behold.
You found one. Wow.
There was a Nemo tube. Guys, you just brought Christmas. In the box.
In the box, brand new.
In the box. Brand new, in the box, Nemo tube. I'm gonna find room for all this. I got a few days. Oh, wow, this is a bin of you.
Brand new. He's telling me to say, Wally, I'm like,
oh, no, this is like super rare.
This is a bin of you. Oh my god, I never thought I'd see one of these.
Is that another number display?
Oh yeah, it's really super special. It's a numerical display, but it uses interference patterns to be able to project numbers. Looks like they have been through this. Shit. Alright, they...
And today... picked through. I mean, they came through here and pretty much after I did the tour and, you know, told everybody, you know, what this stuff was, it's been picked through. All the optical stuff's gone. So those apertures that I was going to use, those aperture controllers are gone. The tape stuff is gone. It's just, these cabinets are now empty. It's just, it's a shame. I the computer boards are gone. It's been torn through. So this is what happens with you know, when you come in to clean out a lab space. You know, once word got out of what was here, after they didn't know what any of the stuff was, and after I basically told them what it was, people came in and just started clearing out the books, all those great books. I didn't have ability to move any of them, but they're all gone. It's a shame, but it's what happens. At least I got it on video. So what is in the film Apollo 13? What is that box? Well, it's actually the speaker for a realistic DX160 multiband AM receiver. And this is it. I decided that I'm going to take my speaker and I'm going to make it into
an Apollo 13 squawk box. So, first thing I had to do was come up with a way of mimicking the logo. Now, an art rendering that I thought was very close to the original that art that they used to make the logo on the prop. Gluing down that logo onto the cardstock, and then once it was dry, I added a laminate covering, plastic laminate covering, to make it waterproof, which took a little burnishing and a little polishing to get that laminate nice and flat, so now it had a plastic coating on the front so that the printing ink wouldn't get smudged or anything if it got wet. And then took the entire laminate card stack and cut it down to size to match the original size of the original logo. And that's pretty much it. But it is, they also do weight it high. It's not actually like in the middle, it's actually like weighted high. So it'll be right to do it the same as they did it in the film. It'll be about there. So just gotta get the hot glue gun ready. There you go, my very own squawk box. Fictitious, but an exact reproduction of the prop they used in the film Apollo 13. Piece of towel, not a sock, piece of towel. The other half of the 4558 that I'm using for the comparator, for the converter, for the sine to square wave converter for the original 60 hertz signal, I'm using the second half of that as a buffer driver to the into the front of the enclosure. Okay, so this is my original drawing of the layout. I've changed it a little bit. And the comparator was bouncing because it was being overdriven because I didn't put the resistor in. It was ringing. I'm running the jigsaw quite slow. It's not really running at a fast speed because I want to very slowly cut away at the aluminum. And I have it, the set also is low. You have the option with a jigsaw, with a good jigsaw, to vary the set. These LEDs, I'm just kind of, again, hot gluing in the back, as you would have in the day, to make a rat's nest of wires and connect up the final connections. So it's all together, and turn the power on, and got the VCD sides working, and the hold count is working. Okay, there it is, on my bench, blinking away, my new bench clock source with real 1 second, 1.000 hertz pulse and BCD output. So I'm using my really cool custom-made BCD 7-segment clock driver box, my bench counter, to drive this. I'm going to show you the display all around. Take it out of the stand. So it's sort of deceptive about the size. You can see my hands here, how big the size is compared to a multimeter. It's kind of big, and I'm only using one LED per segment for this. I have the driver actually mounted on the back here. Just using a 4711 seven segment from BCD driver. I made this in two parts. Created it in AutoCAD, a frontal portion and a back portion. Two pieces. Okay, there's the two pieces. So same number of photons per cubic centimeter. You could kind of calculate it that way for the brightness, and the whole thing goes together really snugly, like so. And So what you're actually looking at, when you're looking at the display, you're actually just looking at the inside of the box being illuminated. So this is the basic idea, and I'd really like to see what people can do with this. One thing that I'm confident about and what I want to experiment with is that this idea, this concept, is very scalable. So you should be able to make displays of any size, even like human size, with this kind of light box concept. One being 18 inches square, which is going to be the base, and then doing a 3 by 18 inch piece, which was going to be a platform which would actually hold the special hinges, these clamp hinges, force fit some nuts, regular hex nuts, a little bit large and flat. Kind of a neat trick. Because I'm going to be making a seal with some caulk. Screws are actually going to do the holding in place. So very careful positioning with those marks that I made. That's pretty much done. So here's the whole assembly. Put the glass plate in. I don't have the vacuum pump yet, but at this point I would turn on the pump to hold it down. Time to put fire to the wire from this one. Ho ho. Yeah. There you go. Got one digit running. I'm only getting one digit to count, which is kind of weird. Whoa! Hey! Awesome! Hey, look at that. It works! It works! All right!
Hello, I'm DeckTalk, the powerful and exciting new text-to-speech system from Digital Equipment Corporation. I can convert standard ASCII text from any computer or terminal into natural-sounding voice. I have many features such as
different voices,
variable rates of speech,
and an unlimited vocabulary.
I can also accept interactive commands from any touch-tone telephone.
You see out here today, so ready? Here goes the camera. Let's start from 10, 9, 8, 7.
All of the files in AutoCAD and then had to convert the files from the DWG AutoCAD format into SVG, scaled vector graphics files that the shaper origin can understand and use. First thing I've got to do is mill out a recess for a pair of washers that are going to be used to hold the bolts that I'm going to use. You can see it milled out a perfect fit, nice and flush. When I'm using the auto-routing function, the detail is actually quite high, and the plunge, and also the speed of the actual routing itself, so no worries about having complete control. I found that a toothbrush is a handy tool when you're doing engraving or small cuts, just a run the toothbrush in there, it gets all the little gravelly bits out of the engraving. The final part was milling out my signature. Alright, well that's it for this one. I'll post some updates on this clock project as I get it together and finish up the case. I'm Fran. I'll see you soon. FranLab.
Quickie!
Hey, it's Fran. Again! in the lab, the filthy lab, drive both the anodes and the cathodes of the multiplexed display. But with this chip, it will only display 24-hour clock output if you run it at 50 hertz. So that's what I did. I went and designed a circuit which converts the 60 hertz line frequency to 50 hertz just for this clock. A transistor to mute out a pulse out of each cycle. So it's cycling 10 times a second, counting to 6. One of those pulses, it mutes out of the output, so that the output from the second op-amp is going to be 5 pulses, 10 times a second, or 50 hertz. In fact, the clock chip's not going to know the difference. It would even be accurate if you wanted to do a converter like this and have a clock that would actually have tenths of seconds. That's how we roll in the Fran Lab. So I'm going to repurpose a lab stand that I got from the UPenn Hall last year. It's got a magnetic base on it, so it's really handy and sort of the perfect base for this project. But I have to make a mount that I can adjust to hold a micrometer that I got. And I really like these hollow boring bits. They make a nice clean hole. I'm going to do this at my framing table with a combination of techniques, which I just clamp down so that I can take some passes with my little Stanley plane. The plane takes down the maple a little bit, enough to form a nice crisp ridge. I go to a hand chisel so I can put a little more of an angle on the surface. So the four-jaw chuck is really the way to go. Well, that's it for this one. If you like this video, then please consider becoming a patron of my YouTube channel. It's real easy to do. Just go to the link in the description and become a patron. I've been getting new tooling for my lathe, and I swapped out the old holder for an AXA type, you know, interchangeable holder system, and so now I got all these pieces of tooling that I'm gonna have to have access to, and I really had a need for a rollaway cart. Just cut one out, use that as a template to make the other two. That's to accommodate that nut-like thing. So now I've got to put pockets in the other two shells. So I got 3 shells that I have to put the pockets in. And I really wasn't sure at the beginning exactly how many pockets I'd have to make for this project, but it ended up being quite a few. Alright, so now that I've got all 3 of the shells done, it's time to do the final assembly. One quick glass final inspection to make sure that I got all of the pockets filled with screws and make sure I didn't miss any. And it's done. There you go. One rollaway cart with tools on it. It's perfect size. It's just right. You can roll away and everything. Just I can stow it right next to the lathe like so. And then when I need to use it, I just roll it out and put it right there, and got all the interchangeable tools for the AXA system, so just drop a tool in place, bump the lever, and you're ready to lathe. I was going to make up a new bracket to be able to mount the new horn, which has a very different kind of mount. I'm going to keep the original screw, though. That'll come in handy. It's metric. I don't have another one. A bit size to drill about halfway through, then flip the plate over and drill through the rest of the way from the back side, and it makes a nice clean flush drill on either side to make sure that there's no sharp edge in there that could propagate out from flexing. Don't want the plate to snap from metal fatigue. The bracket is mounted on the horn. So now I kind of already know which way is positive and negative, even though it's not marked on the horn. Just kind of used intuition and ended up getting it hooked up the right way. Use the original bolt again to mount the new bracket. And there it is. And now, time for the test. Yeah. Now that's a horn. All right. I'm ready to roll. This was won by Michael Avaliotis. Hope I'm pronouncing that correctly. Thank you, Michael. I'm definitely going to put this in the clock repair. There's a resistor and a capacitor that determine the time constant right here, right on the chip. It's a 8.2K resistor and 100 picofarad cap. Still good. Unused pins on these replacement Panaflex displays. Alright. These two are new. This is still original. Alright. Oh, those are nice and crisp. I never use the alarm on any of my clocks. All right. Set the time. Hours. Thanks for watching. And also want to thank all of my patrons who sponsor me on Patreon. You make all of these videos possible. So thank you. They say that you can't polish a turd, but you can sure paint one. That's neither here nor there. No, I decided that I was going to dive into the deep end of the pool and actually clean and restore the weight talker. All right, it is done.
Enter your memory number.
Yeah, I think that's why the buttons are so big. Number one.
Please step on the scale.
All right, step on the scale.
Your weight is 153 pounds. You have gained 144 pounds. Have a nice day.
Fran Lab. I haven't done that one in a while. Well, if you're like me, you're into all things Nixie and all things Tubi. And if, like me, you've gotten some Nixie tubes and tinkered together some displays, then chances are you've gone the easy and cheap route and got one of these little switching power supplies that you readily find on eBay. They pretty much come up at the top of the search when you look for Nixie supply. And I actually tried to use one of these, although without a load on it, I could get this up to like 200 volts on a multimeter, but this didn't have anywhere near the current to even drive one Nixie tube. So I just said, screw the switching supplies. Let's just make for the bench a real Nixie supply. And so I built this supply that I call Big Iron. It's based around a Stancor PS8416 tube driving transformer. And I've got it running a little Nixie module that I've built just for testing, driving it with my super cool real-time BCD clock driver bench supply. Well, you're not going to have a full bright display if you run a half-wave rectifier without a condenser. The other thing you want to take in consideration with making a high-voltage supply with or without a cap and whether it's full-wave or half-wave is the load, because if you don't have a particularly large load, then half-wave rectifier and a full-wave rectifier, you're not going to see a whole lot of difference as far as bogging down with load. But if you're powering up a condenser, obviously if twice the duty cycle is going to keep that capacitor charged a lot more readily under load than if you are running a half-wave rectifier. It's got the full lead length to put it into something else in the future. I put all the electronics onto a single circuit board using my standard heat-synced LM317 for the 5-volt supply. I fused the high voltage with a 1-amp fuse, you know, just in case. I put all the hardware onto the board, sort of really traditional breadboard style with just a set of spacers on the PCB, just keep it off of the deck. That's pretty much it. Pretty simple construction. I'm a big fan of this kind of breadboard style, as you know. Yeah, it's fully intact. Boy, it's got the glow-in-the-dark dial. Boy, let me check that. I wonder if that's radium.
That is radium. This is a radioactive clock. That's what radiation sounds like. Hey, it's Fran, again. But I have some bad news. Turns out, I'm being evicted. I'm the last one left on this side of the building, so the absolute quiet has been great for my work, but has caused me great anxiety. And the reason for this is that during the summer, a few months ago, this building was bought by a new company. People have been getting pushed out of this building for months, so I'm very worried. So as a precaution, I have had to get a new storage facility, a big one. Well, my friends, my viewers, my patrons, that is the situation. I can't buy the property. It is for sale, but I can't buy it. Because I'm of the economic class where the only way that I could buy a property is if I had cash in a briefcase. That's it. And this isn't my first time around the block. It's not my first rodeo, they say now, in trying to purchase property. I've tried to purchase properties in the past a few times, and I've always ended up in some version of this, no person's land economically, where I could show that I had a really good amount of gross receipts in a year, but the bank isn't going to look at that. They're going to look at my taxable net personal income for my solvency. So if I'm paying $40,000 a year in rent, they don't count that. I have to have profit, personal income and profit above and beyond all business expenses as a personal business to even qualify for a loan, for a mortgage. And that's the reality of it. So when people want to comment, I bought my property, you're a fool to rent, you know, only idiots rent, you know, why don't you buy? You're a fool throwing it away with the rent. Well, people in my economic class, we all rent from landlords. I've rented all my life because I don't have the economic power to buy. A bank isn't going to give someone like me a loan, you know? And there are millions, tens of millions of people, hundreds of millions maybe, in this country that are in my exact same boat, who will never own a house, always rent, even at ridiculously high prices. And when they're pushed out of a property, they're forced into another property, renting from another landlord. And I told the guy on the phone, it's like, I said, look, in 10 years, I'm going to spend $350,000 in rent. And a bank isn't going to think, we could have taken that money in the form of a mortgage, you know? But no, I'll pay $350,000 in 10 years in rent to a landlord rather than even having a shot at owning a property of that same value because I don't have cash in a briefcase. And that is the straight poop. Hey, it's Fran again in the lab, as you'd expect. Well, I finally went and put it all together. My handheld digital audio recorder based on that chip with the insertable removable cartridges. It's done. It was a little bit, this turned out to be like a 3-day long project. I spent about 3 solid days turning this into this. Also, in this project, I wanted to take full potential of the possibilities of printing everything I needed. So rather than like jury-rigging things in there, I really decided that I was going to go all the way and do it right with the 3D printer. Let me show you how I went about making this. So I spent about a day designing a model that I could create in AutoCAD, and that really was created not so much in the computer, but in my mind space. That's sort of why I use AutoCAD, because I pretty much create it in my mind space, and then using AutoCAD, I'm just basically translating what I've already sort of constructed and making it into something real. But it took a little while to, you know, make sure that the tolerances were going to work. But I knew I was going to have a very difficult fit with the perf board, because I was going to have to hand populate the perf board, and I was going to have to mount it in there with 4 standoffs. And so I made it easy on myself.
I knew the distance between the header and the switch that'd be mounted on the board, because that's sort of established by the matrix of the perf board. So I decided that in order to get the fit right with the standoffs, that I would create the standoffs separately and print them separately. So that was one thing. The other thing was that I knew that the header would have to be elevated off the board to be at the right height for the switch. So rather than sort of guesstimating that, I thought that I would do it the right way and make a custom spacer for that header that I created in AutoCAD and printed out separately, and put that in as well. Worked pretty well. Ah, I'm like a kid again. I love this stuff. This is exactly what I wanted it to be. It's just perfect. So anyway, that's it. I'm Fran.
My patrons really rock.
I'll see you around real soon. Bye.
My patrons really rock. My patrons really rock.
You remember the custom clock case that I made a little while back? Well, I wanted to make some special custom-made bolts to hold the two parts of the clock case together that would be nice and decorative. I've got a piece of brass stock in the chuck, and I've gotten really good at centering ever since I made my little centering guide. You can get it within a mil or two of runout, which is pretty good as a starting point for making a couple of knobs that I'm going to make to fit onto a pair of regular off-the-shelf bolts that I'm going to cut down on the outside of the clock. So I've got a chuck mounted in the tailstock, and putting a good blob of cutting oil on an end mill, I'm going to very slowly start a hole in the end of the brass and then plunge it in. And the end mill is going to create a very specific kind of cone shape in the end of the brass that is just the right angle to fit on a live center. And just taking it down 10 mils at a time. The little knurlers, they're sort of dug in, and so they're spinning around and creating the grooves. And after a few passes, you pretty much have the knurls done. So I got two knobs. No, they're basically done. I actually didn't record putting the quarter-inch hole in the bottom of the first knob, but I actually did do that a few months ago, and just going through until it plunges all the way through. Now, unfortunately, it broke off a little early, so it's got a little nib on it, and I'm going to take that off later in a final step. That bar, a tap, it unsticks the chuck. And also, when I did the parting, the knob actually banged into the parting tool and left a little nick, so I'm actually going to do a couple more passes, just a couple mils down. And final inspection, it really looks great. I'm very happy with this. It just couldn't have turned out any better, I must say. Very pleased with that. So yeah, so now I've got two custom head bolts to finish off this clock. And you know, you can go and buy off the rack, sure, but there is really nothing more satisfying than making something custom from raw stock all by yourself. Anyway, that's it for this one. Thanks for watching. Thanks too to all my patrons who support this channel. You make all these videos possible. Thank you. Hey, it's Fran, and time again for another Pencils and Pens video for fall of 2018. I said in the review that I thought it was a terrible name for a company, the TWSBI. Yada yada, but people have told me in the comments, no, it's pronounced Twisby. You're supposed to say Twisby. You pick it up and start writing with it. How reliable is it? This one is surprisingly good, but I gotta be honest with you. Every fountain pen that I'll ever use or review or compare is measured against the Parker 51. This is the end-all be-all of all pens, not just fountain pens. Very famously, click on cap with the patented seal. And so yeah, I as far as writability, reliability, usability, and every other respect, every pen that I ever will use is compared to the Parker 51. Classic nib. The ink delivery is very classic. With all the Palominos, they have the completely removable, changeable, adjustable eraser so that as the eraser wears down, you can extend it out. You know, you just take it out of the holder. It's got these little jaws. You can extend it out a little bit, put it back in as you wear the eraser down. And if you're like me and go through erasers faster than you actually go through the pencil, you can put a completely new eraser right on it and finish the pencil all the way down to the nub if you want. So if you really like writing with pencils, as I do, you will find that the Palomino is top of the heap. Hey, it's Fran again in my discombobulated lab as usual, but with a huge announcement for everyone who's been, you know, watching these commentary videos the last couple months, and particularly those of you who pitched in to the GoFundMe campaign to get a new lab space. I'm here to tell you I have a new lease, 3-year lease with an option to renew for another 3, so it's essentially a locked 6-year lease on a new space, paid for. I put down the deposit and everything. I gotta say though, it was a very large sum of money that I had to put down to lock this space, which I'm gonna take possession of in March, hopefully. So a couple months, probably January, sometime in January, I'm gonna have to be shutting down completely and just get into the full-time tearing up and moving thing. It was a very difficult negotiation. It turns out that GoFundMe campaign was necessary because there were, without those funds, it would have been impossible for me to get a space. It's really weird because all my adult life I've never had a problem getting a space to live and work in. Never had an issue with you know, qualifying for a lease or anything, but the rules have really changed. Especially in the city, the last few years only. And there were just so many places that would not give me a lease. And this one, I negotiated a lease that turned out to be very fair in the long run. You know, over the course of 6 years, it's fair, but I had to put down a large chunk of that GoFundMe money to get in and get it signed. So, yesterday I wrote the largest single check of my entire life by like a huge margin, that's it. It's a done deal, so it's gonna take a lot of time, so be patient. I hope the patrons, you've been very understanding, and I'm hoping that you very valuable patrons can hang in there for January, February, March. April, I'll be back up and running full tilt. So here we go. New adventure. Fran Lab will survive. Actual display portion, you could call that the anode, and the plate, which is at 15 volts, that dropping 1 meg resistor. In the interior there, you see the white heater, and surrounded around that white heater is a spiraled cathode, which emits the electrons, which are going in all directions. But that's all the gain that this particular display needs to activate the electrode and deflect the beam down the cap and extend out like a, you know, a press panel like this, but have it come up here. So that this could be, and have a punch out, so that that could be put on the panel. How slick is that? Yeah. And connect the wire from lug 2, condenser C7 to lug 1. And it'll straighten the tubes. So take the 9-pin, put it in here and just kind of wiggle it down on, you know, wiggle it down in, and all the pins are straight. So it should just go right in the socket. And oh, there we go. All the springs, there we go. That's feeding back like crazy. This is is all part of the Heathkit thing, you know? You build it, it doesn't work. Well, kind of doesn't work. I mean, it was working there for a while, and then it started feeding back kind of randomly. So it's something intermittent. Something intermittent causing feedback in there. I guess you really wanted that to be permanent in the effect. Putting those into the production units, I was able to make 9-volt battery-operated stomp boxes that were true bypass with indicator light. And as far as I know, I was the first to do that in battery-powered pedals. And as it goes from low pass to high pass, that's the low pass end. It's going to cross over, and you're going to see the two knees. There you go. And now it's going high pass. That's the signature. That's what the suite looks like. That's the signature at 1 kilohertz. Hey, it's Fran in the land of crates. This is what the whole place has become. And I know I said that I wasn't going to do any more videos for the interim, but it's getting kind of long. It's been almost a month, so just want to let you know where things are. I'm just sort of in the middle, kind of got ahead on the packing and ran into a little bit of a snag with the moving out, because it looks like we had to move things over just a little bit in the future as far as getting the stuff moved. So it's going to take a little longer to get it moved in March than I thought, but by mid-March this should all be over there, and that's just a matter of putting it all back together again. This time, I wanted to highlight my workbench, because a lot of people have been asking about the workbench, and I've talked about it kind of briefly in other videos, and I tweeted about it back when I used to do social media stuff, but I really thought that the bench really deserves its own video, because it is such a marvelous, spectacular workbench. So this framing bench, it's a shaker version of a French framing bench. It's kind of unique. It dates back to the 1880s, 1890s. It was purportedly made in Philadelphia, and so it is sort of a shaker style. It has an unusually sturdy base to it. The whole bench is solid old growth maple. And the top, just the tabletop, weighs well over 100 pounds, like 120 pounds, so just gravity keeps the whole thing together. The end vise is very versatile. It's probably the most useful vise in the bench, because it'll hold down a flat piece very sturdily, and you can use it to do cutting and chiseling of objects that are that you need to work on the ends. And the one thing about a bench like this is all of the mojo that comes with it. You get all of the scars from 140 years of work, paint cans and varnish, and you can see here where one of the owners preferred to put their cigarettes on the very edge of the tool bed. And it's just all this mojo. It's what I love about the bench. It's just all the histories right there, and the great thing about having a bench like this is you get to add to it. So as I use the bench, I add my signature to its history. And like Neil Young said in his song about the guitar, this old bench is mine for a little while. Well, that's it about the bench. Fantastic bench, made in Philadelphia by who knows who, but it is quite marvelous. I'm overexposed. Isn't that always the truth for me? Hey, it's Fran again, and I said in the last video about the lab at the Land of Crates that the next video I'd probably make would be an empty room. Well, this is it. Hello! This is the new space, Echo, and waiting to be filled. Acquired it. I'm in the process of cleaning it up. I've got to do some preparations for the movers coming, and I'm getting some things done in here that have to be done for, basic infrastructure and stuff, but this will be the new lab space, and the next time you see this, all the desks and stuff will be right in here. Hey! It's Fran. For the first time, officially, in the semi-completed new lab space. Lots of sunlight and stuff. So, this is got the big table here, all in the same. So I've combined the old space, the two different areas into one sort of efficient storage right here. Got four different workstations sort of neatly nestled in here. Ooh, all right, so yeah, this is the other sort of area, the main area that I'm going to be using with table one. I don't have everything set up yet, but it will be coming together because this is overall a smaller space, so things have to be more efficient, and I'm basically just weeding through everything and just sort of separating what I want on the benches and what I'm going to have to stow. As long as this place doesn't blow up or something, hopefully we can, you know, get the channel back up to where it was. If I get more people to watch the channel, if I can get more people to sign on to the Patreon thing, you know, this year, then hopefully, as we get into the winter 2019, hopefully things will be economically, they're going to have to. So, as it turned out, that GoFundMe campaign was not only successful, but it really and truly saved FranLab. It turns out that if I hadn't gotten the amount that I did, we wouldn't be sitting here today, not at this table, and FranLab would be gone for good. I brought in a total of $44,205, and that was brought in by 1,333 people. These numbers alone, this still blows my mind. I just can't believe that it was that this many people chipped in to save FranLab. I'm still stunned when I look at these numbers. But yeah, so right off the top, we had fees. Right off the top, that's GoFundMe fees, processing fees, credit fees, and everything. That comes right off the top out of that. Was $6,652 in tax. That just went to the government right there. What I paid the movers plus the insurance and boxes, crates, all the fees, everything that had to do with moving came into $10,500. What I didn't foresee, and this is the part that really kind of got me, was that as I started to look for new properties, I was being turned down. I looked for a good solid 3 months. I looked at dozens and dozens of properties, and there were at least three other properties that I really thought would be suitable and great, and I just could not get leases on those properties. I was finding it very hard to get a landlord that was willing to give a lease to someone like me, who's self-supported, self-financed, that I don't have a punched clock type job with a steady income that I can show that I've had for many years. That was just cutting me out of every single deal. And a lot of these other properties, they would only give me a 1 year lease and they would not guarantee me that they'd even renew. And I had one space that was like, well, we'll just give you 1 year and you gotta pay the whole thing up front, but we're not gonna guarantee that you can spend a second year. And of course it would just be disastrous. So I ended up getting a 6 year lease on this property, but there was a huge deposit to get that deal. Just the deposit was $11,100. The whole tally comes out to $29,935, which leaves a surplus of $14,270. That's what we got left. $14,270. And as I had mentioned in the last video, I'd be sitting so pretty if we hadn't got the eviction. But as a result of the eviction, the move, the new circumstance, the new reality of the new real estate market, because I had to break up the lab, and now that we've got 25% less space for this space, although it's more suitable for FranLab, there wasn't enough room for everything, so I had to get another space and a bigger storage space, so I had to split the storage between here and the new storage space, and I had to get that other workspace for the sewing and other stuff. So splitting up the lab, the new overhead costs, utilities, everything, there's lots of hidden fees in this kind of operation. That the total overage that I have now as of 2019 over last year is an increase of about 37% overall cost. So as of 2019, currently, with Patreon, t-shirt sales, and all the other stuff that I do, FranLab is, as of today, is about 63% funded. Not 100% funded, like it was last year. We're 63% funded. So this overage is going to be used to take up the slack. But yeah, you actually do the majority of this. And so FranLab is your channel. Again, thank you for saving FranLab. And thank you for bringing about FranLab 2.0. Right. Well, that's it. End of the money talk. From here on out, it's all going to be lab, lab, lab. That's it. Bye! Still here? It's over. Go home.